even if it's 50 cents, a dollar, a few dollars, to help defray some of the costs that Cynthia incurred in planning and executing this event. I'll pass some baskets. Thank you.
We also have a few brownies at the Code Pink table that I made. And they're really, really special. They don't have any kind of medicine in them or anything like that. They're just chocolate, which is really good for you. So come by our table, and Eleanor will be sitting there, our wonderful Eleanor Levine will be sitting there dispensing the brownies for a donation. I'm actually up next. And does anybody not know what this represents? Because what I wanted to do was to show you what we did with the hood, because there's no senses loud, there's no sound, there's no sight, there's no hearing, there's nothing. When you are captured and renditioned and sent to Guantanamo, you have no senses available to you. And we've heard horrible, horrible stories of torture. And that torture continues. They let somebody out yesterday, right? They let a Kuwaiti out, but there are still about 50 Guantanamo prisoners who were cleared for release many, many years ago who are still in Guantanamo prisons. And we need to let them out. Cheney to take off the gloves. He said, your ass is covered by these legal memos, these legal opinions I'm giving you, and you can do this and not have to worry about ever being prosecuted. Well, he was wrong. John Yu was wrong on every count. They rescinded his legal opinions because they were shoddy research, they were not good law, and he is teaching students law? Is that okay?
No!
Tomorrow is the anniversary of Guantanamo receiving its first prisoners, and some of us are going to go to the law school tomorrow because that's sort of symbolic, because they employ that war criminal. We're going to go up there and we're going to call for his indictment and prosecution once again, and we have been doing this for years. Because the law school doesn't respond. They don't respond. They've endowed a chair for John Yu to add insult to injury. They've endowed a chair for John Yu. And you know who pushed for that? The former dean of the law school, Christopher Edley, who said that he agreed that John Yu did the wrong thing. Yeah. Yeah. So they're full of it, but we're not going up there tomorrow to call for his firing. We're going up there to call for his prosecution, because that is what he should happen to him. No man is above the law, they say, and this is true. And we have to make sure it's true in our country, because if people are above the law, then what have we got? The Wild West or something. Okay, the other thing.
What time is the demonstration?
That we're meeting at noon in front of the law school. It's on Bancroft Way and College Avenue. And we are a delegation. We are not hundreds of people. The media likes to say, five people showed up, or 20 people showed up. It's not about how many are showing up. It's about what we're calling for and what we are saying over and over again. John, you should be in prison. You should be in the dock, okay? So it's not okay. We need to shut Guantanamo prison. We can't continue. So I'm urging everybody to do what they know they have to do, which is to pressure Obama, because it is solely his decision. It's blaming it on Congress, as we know, is just a cop-out. He has the authority to tell Congress, in 30 days I want to release these 45 people. All he has to do is notify them. In 30 days they can be out. So that's all it takes. Now, many of you know that I was on a hunger strike for 84 days. And I wasn't alone in that. There were prisoners at Guantanamo still on hunger strike. And they were the inspiration for that. And there were prisoners at Pelican Bay and prisons around the country who were held in solitary who were also on hunger strikes. And they were the inspiration for that. And Witness for Peace's just went to Guantanamo and tried to get as close to the prison as they could. And they are fasting. They are on hunger strike right now in Washington, D.C. in the freezing cold there. They are not eating. Okay? What can we do? We can go and call for the prosecution of John New, who is responsible for the torture that those men have endured at Guantanamo prison. And I mentioned Jamel Amitsian earlier, the Algerian who was repatriated to Algeria. He is suing the United States with the help of the Center for Constitutional Rights because he was tortured. It wasn't just three people who were waterboarded. That is a crock, okay? Lots of them were waterboarded and lots of them were tortured, and we can't let that stand. We have to do something about that. So please join us tomorrow at 11 at UC Law School, and then witness, Code Pink and World Can't Wait are meeting at 1 o'clock at Montgomery Street Station in San Francisco. And we have some of these orange jumpsuits for you to wear, and we are gonna march in solemn procession through downtown San Francisco just to remind people that prison's still there and those people are still suffering and we can't let that happen any longer. Thank you for listening, and I would like to introduce the next speaker, which is Shahid Buttar, an old colleague. I can't say enough good things about him, but he's amazing. He is a good lawyer, unlike John Yu. He is actually a good lawyer. Shahid.
My name is Shahid Buttar. I'm going to represent a couple of organizations this evening. Thank you, Mike. Mostly with the theme of police militarization. And I do just want to riff off of one segue from Cynthia's comments. I just came back to the Bay. I moved here in September after spending 12 years in Washington, where I went after I graduated from law school at Stanford the year that the war broke out. And I basically ditched the third year of law school to organize against the war. And when I was in D.C., we filed cases around campaign finance. We held up part of the bulwark that was taken down by Citizens United. Filed one of the first cases seeking marriage equality on the East Coast back in 2004. Seen a lot of things won and lost. And I will say that at least with respect to all things national security, we live in an age of profound dystopia. And I'll just note it's a week. Today is a week before the 65th anniversary of the closing address of the last U.S. president, who was an actual war hero. That's President Eisenhower, Ike, who warned us in his last address to the American people to be scared of what he created, which was a military-industrial complex at the time one to be regarded necessary to keep the world free. And I dare say that what we learned from Edward Snowden 2 summers ago reveals what its fangs look like to the American people. And I'm going to talk a little bit in the context of police militarization about the further dimensions of domestic surveillance. It is not merely the case that the NSA is monitoring everything you do online and the entire phone system. That is happening too. So there's a high-tech dimension to the Panopticon. And the group I work for during the day, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, we, among other things, are, thank you, two of the major litigation projects challenging mass NSA surveillance are ones that our organization filed. That's Jewel versus NSA and First Unitarian Church of Los Angeles versus NSA. I'll note we're in a UU church, so homage and props to our hosts. In addition to that work in the courts, we also do work in the legislatures, and I think this is where I want to try to focus your attention on some things that are moving here in California. And it's exciting, actually, to stand here at Berkeley to reflect upon this. It was, I think, 5 years ago that I first started working with George Lipman, who's on your city's Peace and Justice Commission, and a whole host of people here in Berkeley, a very diverse coalition that emerged, the Coalition for a Safe Berkeley, that I dare say in Berkeley has done a great deal to inform other jurisdictions, namely among the things that your community did a year and a half ago, might have been 2 years ago now, was require before the police collect intelligence information, that is to say information unrelated to a criminal incident, there has to be a reasonable suspicion of connection to some criminal activity. That might seem very straightforward. It should in a free country. It does not exist in most places around the country. You're already pioneers. I want to focus you on a couple things that just happened in Sacramento and one that you can expect coming up this year. So, and these are still things that the Electronic Frontier Foundation worked on. At least one of them, the Stop Urban Shield Coalition, had a piece in. And these are twin bills to restrict the use of automatic license plate readers and Stingray cell site replicators. So these are high-tech surveillance tools that are used by local police to conduct what I'll describe as ambient surveillance. So the Fourth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution requires, it guarantees your protection from unreasonable searches and seizures. What that's supposed to require is some individualized basis for suspicion. It's been thrown out the window with contemporary policing practice, and police militarization is a big part of that. Just to now connect myself to Cynthia, I wanted to make this segue earlier, but it didn't make sense at the time. Do people know why the police are militarized in the United States, historically? That's why we have police, but why they're militarized is actually much more recent than that. In the late 80s and early 90s, police departments in Los Angeles and Miami started getting outgunned by narco traffickers, and here's the kicker, trained, funded, and equipped by the CIA. And we know these facts now to be true. Nobody did at the time, or at least in any confirmable way. The CIA Inspector General admitted this 15 years ago, that the CIA is at the roots of the, not merely the war on drugs, but the import of them in the first place. That was the predicate to militarize the police. Fast forward to Ferguson. Think about how militarized police were used in the United States to suppress domestic dissent responding to police abuses. It's like standing between mirrors, right? It is more sordid than only one time slice would reveal when viewed over time. And then go back to Eisenhower's warning, right? He predicted this. And so we have a great deal to do to make real the promise of freedom in the United States. But in Sacramento, these two bills to restrain automatic license plate readers and Stingray devices did at least a tiny bit of that. And what they did, among other things, was require local police departments that will deploy these devices. And license plate readers are used, you put it on the back of a car, drive around a neighborhood, it scans all the license plates, and then can report to, for instance, state agencies who might be matching an outstanding warrant database, or who might have parking tickets unpaid, or who might have been at the gathering for that political movement that is now, you know, the target du jour for state authorities. Stingray devices are often mounted in the air or on fixed locations, but they look like cell phone towers to your phone. So when you use your phone within range of one, the upshot, the benefit is you get free cell phone service on the government, except that it's capturing all the data and voice going through the phone connection. And it's not just the target of the investigation, it's anyone within range. It's ambient surveillance, lacking that individual suspicion required under the Fourth Amendment. There's been a sea change, a constitutional revolution, without the amendment that somebody earlier was talking about fighting for in the context of campaign finance, right? Without a constitutional amendment, the ground has shifted under our feet, and we can thank the CIA for that, but we can reclaim power through our state legislatures and our city councils. These bills out of Sacramento that just took effect require local police departments to gain public approval. Huge deal. That was in before it would happen in the dead of night. Now there are huge hooks to require approval before the fact of purchase. That will be very opportune for activists organizing on the ground, and I just want to shout out one group doing that locally, the Stop Urban Shield Coalition, meets once a month, every Monday. The organization's particularly concerned, do clap, it's a great group here that includes, someone earlier was talking about the representation of people like myself of different ethnicities, and this Stop Urban Shield Coalition, to its vast credit, is remarkably diverse and people of color led, and very much on the front end of resisting the militarization of your police here in Alameda County. There is an Urban Shield as a training exercise that goes along with grants to police departments to conduct training that, for instance, will paint local residents as targets of operations, right? Deeply offensive, right? I mean, to protect and serve or to use as targets in training exercises. And these are the sorts of training exercises that often lead to the kind of interagency collaboration that you saw, for instance, at Occupy Oakland, the night that the Iraq veterans, Scott Olson, got sent to the hospital in a coma after surviving his armed deployment abroad to supposedly keep his country safe. We've talked about the Electronic Frontier Foundation. We've talked about the Stop Urban Shield Coalition. I want to also mention another organization I used to work for and am now on the board of with my colleague, local resident Mike Rufo, the Bill of Rights Defense Committee. We recently merged with the Defending Dissent Foundation, and we work with groups like the Stop Urban Shield Coalition around the country, mobilizing diverse Americans across ideology. The left-right convergence around freedom, progressives and libertarians have a lot to say to each other in this environment. And what used to be a left-right division in our country on policing issues is shifting into a center versus periphery division, where you have an establishment, a bipartisan establishment in Washington and around the country that supports security theater at the detriment of our constitutional rights, quite frankly, risking our democracy, at least in the purported effort to secure it. That bipartisan establishment has to fear a not isolated attack from either of the wings. The only thing it could, has to fear is a coordinated attack from both of the wings. And that, of course, is one that would defend the rights of Americans from all ethnic, demographic, and religious communities. And so because this is a harm that impacts us as Americans, despite our different ideologies, faiths, backgrounds, it's that kind of movement that has to emerge in order to stop it. And to go back to what Cynthia was talking about the continuation, for instance, of indefinite detention under a Democratic president, thinking about, and I'm really excited to see in this room representation from so many different organizations of these, but it will take civil society. What we're talking about here at root is more than just a policy struggle. Across many of these issues that we're talking about, what we're ultimately talking about is liberating a country that pretends to be free. And think about what that takes and means and what role each of us has to play in it. Thank you so much for being here.
I just want to tell you real quick the rest of the night. We're cutting short our presentations. Anne Fagan Ginger is next. And then we have Susan Harmon talking about public banking, postal banking, Toby Blomay from Code Pink on ending drone wars, supporting drone whistleblowers. George Lippman from Berkeley Peace and Justice Commission on Police Accountability, Anna Cecilia Blackshaw on Standing Up for Racial Justice, and finally, Jean Herman, Actions for Civilizing the Police. So take it away.
Okay, we are honored with Anne Fagan Ginger. I do want to pass Ruthie Sackheim, who's the great organizer of the Occupy forums in the city, is with us tonight, and she's going to pass out the piece of paper you have there. And we are on schedule. Anne is going to speak for 10 minutes. We are deeply honored to have Anne Fagan Ginger with us to speak for 10 minutes. She's a tremendous, an amazing history of civil rights work and of legal work, and she's from the Mickleton Civil Liberties Institute, reporting on UN, with the UN on human rights violations. And it's all yours. Thank you very, very much for coming.
Thank you.
Is that good?
You hear? Yes. I'm a Euro-American resolutionary. And like everyone in the room, I'm a resident of the city of Berkeley, county of Alameda, state of California, United States of America, Organization of American States, and United Nations. And I want to talk about two plans of action that have not been mentioned by anybody here so far. One is described by what happened in New Orleans after 2005, when you know the people fled across the Katrina. After the earthquake, they fled across the bridge, black people and people of low income, and they were shot by the police, and nothing was done about it. And so Mickleton Civil Liberties Institute wrote a letter to the United Nations Human Rights Committee and described this and said that it was a violation of international law. And the UN Human Rights Committee at its meeting discussing the United States decided that this was true. And they wrote a very strong, what they call concluding observations, describing exactly what the United States government should have done to arrest, try, convict, sentenced, and send to prison the police officers who had so acted.
Wow.
And they issued that concluding observations, which got no coverage in the U.S. press, but they did it because Micklejohn Institute proposed it to them. And after a while, the state of Louisiana did hold a trial of the police officers. They were careful not to put on enough witnesses so that they were acquitted. But then the federal government, because of the pressure from the United Nations Human Rights Committee, held a second trial, and this time the proper witnesses were put on, and the policemen were convicted and sentenced and sent to prison. And what I would like to point out to you is that we in the United States are part of the Organization of American States and the United Nations. And on every one of the issues that was mentioned tonight, it would be proper and a good idea if the organizers would write a letter or a complaint or a grievance or a description of the problem and send it to the UN Human Rights Committees that are in charge of this subject so that they would do the same thing that happened about New Orleans. The organizations, we have seven treaties that we are, laws that we haven't discussed tonight. The United Nations Charter, Article 55, is the human rights articles. Then we have the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. We have the Convention Against Torture and Other Cruel, Inhuman, or Degrading Treatment or Punishment. We have the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination, and we have the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. And we have the International Convention on the Rights of Indigenous People and the Convention on the Rights of the Disabled. All of these have been signed by the U.S. presidents, ratified by the Senate, and in that statement, when they ratified, they agreed to publicize the text. How many of you had ever heard of any of these treaties before tonight, or heard of all of them? Very few people have. The United States has done nothing whatever to publicize the text. And I think that on all of the issues that have been mentioned tonight, if the people would write a very careful description of what rights were denied, and then look in the three treaties, Covenant on Civil and Political, Convention Against Torture, Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. Look in those treaties, find which article is being denied or violated, and send a communication to the UN committees that are involved. I think you would find that they would act. And I think the failure of the government or the whatever group is violating the laws to obey the law would become an international issue, and I think that would be very helpful. The second point I wanted to make, how many of you have heard of the Office of Inspector General?
Yes.
Every single government body has an Office of Inspector General, and it would be very important on each of the issues you've raised, if you filed a complaint, a grievance, a description with the Office of Inspector General of that agency, and I think as a result, they would do something. They would make some kind of a statement, and I think that that would be helpful. It is very important to do all the work you're doing. I think in addition to that, it's important to understand we're part of the United Nations, we're part of the world, and if we tell the United Nations committees that there are violations, it will have an impact. Now, the reality is that the United States has signed three more treaties: the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, and the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. And when a country has signed a treaty under international law, they're not supposed to disobey it. The only difference is that after it's ratified by the Senate, the U.S. would have to send a report to those committees. But if your issue is one that involves children or women, or an economic issue, I think that you also should send a description of the problem to those international UN committees with a copy to the three committees that we have ratified the treaties of. And I suggest that this getting into the, you're getting used to the idea, not just of going to the city council or the board of supervisors or the state legislature or the Congress, but getting into the part of the United Nations, which is affirmative, these committees, I think it would be a great step forward and would be an appropriate thing to do in the city of Berkeley. And I might add that we have adopted in the city of Berkeley the Human Rights Ordinance, which is the same language as Article 55 of the UN Charter. And in 1990, I just took out the word United Nations shall promote human rights and put in the word City of Berkeley, and it was adopted. And I think it's important for us to be part of the world on our side, as just as the United States tries to run things. And in my discussion about the United Nations, I'm not discussing the Security Council, which the U.S. government has a big hand in. I'm talking about the UN Human Rights Committees, where the U.S. government has no hand. So I hope that you will think about taking these steps in order to change where we're at, so that we take advantage of the laws that we have in hand in order to make steps forward. Thank you.
Hey, Susan. She also called Pink, of course. Pink.
I want to do a little segue from what Shahid was talking about really briefly first. And that's that there's another group that's been involved in police militarization and surveillance, and that's the Oakland Privacy Working Group, which comes out of Occupy Oakland. Occupy Oakland is alive and well, as is Occupy San Francisco. And Oakland Privacy Working Group has done a huge amount of work. So they belong in that list that Shahid mentioned. So how does banking fit into this conglomerate of issues? Well, it can finance all of them. We talk about all the things that should be happening in the world, and often we come to a dead stop when we say, well, we just don't have the money to do it. Money should be a public resource, and it should not be, the creation of money should not be under the jurisdiction of private banks, which is where it is right now. It should be a government function. So we are advocating for public banks at every level. Oakland could have a public bank. There could be a regional East Bay or even Bay Area public bank. There could be a state of California public bank. And we're working on all of those levels to make that happen. So if you want to get involved with public banking, please see me. And I will hook you up with the efforts that we are making. You should know that three of the four members of the Finance Committee of the Oakland City Council support public banking. So why they haven't done it, I don't know, and I will start harassing them on Tuesday when they have their next meeting. One form of public banking that we could do essentially tomorrow is postal banking. You may not know that this country had postal banking until 1967. It was phenomenally successful, and it was only shut down by the big banks, by Wall Street. So we could have it again tomorrow if the Postmistress General agreed. And a couple weeks before Christmas, the four postal unions, in a coalition with other good government groups, delivered 150,000 signatures to her, asking her to start postal banking. It could happen tomorrow. Write to your congresspeople, your senators. They can make it happen. And I want to tell you, Ruthie Sackheim, the famous Ruthie Sackheim, who Occupy San Francisco Forum, encouraged me to tell you a short inspirational story about how unpredictable it is, how unpredictable our actions are. You know, sometimes we work and work and work, and it looks as though we don't make any progress. But it's not always immediately visible, and it's certainly not predictable. So back 3 or 4 years ago, when the Berkeley Post Office was under siege, when Dianne Feinstein's husband, the wonderful Richard Bloom, decided to sell the Berkeley Post Office to his friends, a friend of mine was one of the people who was organizing, a retired postal worker. And I sent him an article by Ellen Brown, who is the queen of postal banking, talking about, she's the queen of public banking, but this was an article about postal banking. And I sent it to him three times before he paid attention. So persistence is one of those qualities, along with hope, that is a verb that we need to employ. The third time, he turned her article into a resolution, took it to the annual conference of his union, one of the four postal unions. They passed it, then he and I worked to get it passed by the three other postal unions, and now the postal unions have taken up the cause of postal banking. So that was two people doing something that seemed utterly hopeless and pointless. That has now put postal banking in the presidential debates. Bernie Sanders is supporting it. Hillary Clinton will probably come out for it any minute now, as she is wont to do, following him. And it could happen. It really could happen. And it would be the first major step in public banking in 100 years. So, thank you.
Come on up, Eleanor, to talk about our drone assassination program, our drone warfare program, our illegal drone warfare program, and supporting the drone whistleblowers, which is a wonderful, hopeful thing. We have drone pilots who are coming forward and saying they don't want to do it anymore and we shouldn't be doing it. Here's Eleanor.
Just a few brief words. Toby has been working very hard on all sorts of drone stuff and went home to sleep. So I want to just invite you to participate in three things. The first is we go to Creech Air Force Base in Nevada, which is about an hour north of Las Vegas. Creech Air Force Base is the place from which the Air Force and the CIA control drones that drop payloads all over the world, particularly in the Middle East. You all know that drones are pilotless planes. We invite you to join us at Creech. We're going back for our spring offensive, and we will be there in March of this year. We camp out. We stay at a place called the Goddess Temple, which is just down the road from the Air Force Base. Some people stay in Las Vegas. We work together in coalition with a lot of groups. It's Code Pink, Nevada Desert Experience, Catholic Worker, Veterans for Peace, IVAW, and lots of other groups that I can't think of at the moment. So we invite you to join us for our spring offensive at Creech Air Force Base. It's a good learning experience. We have lots of seminars. We have lots of educational stuff going on. We have morning vigils and afternoon vigils. And what I think is encouraging is that we now get many more people who give us peace signs when they enter and leave the base. And that's really important. And there are many more drone pilots who have left the service who are now coming forward as whistleblowers. And we would like to think that the work that we've done over the years against drones and exposing what drones do, the devastation that they bring, has a lot to do with that. So we invite you to join us at Creech. We also invite you to join us at Beale Air Force Base. Beale Air Force Base is north in California near Marysville. The drones that are controlled or flown from Beale don't carry a payload. They don't carry any weapons, but they're surveillance drones. Those are the Global Hawks. At Creech, they fly Predators, and they fly, what's the other one? The Predators and the Reapers. And those are the ones that will drop bombs and missiles and other kinds of things. But from Beale, the Global Hawks are the surveillance weapon of the Air Force and the military. We invite you to join us. We go once a month to Beale Air Force Base, joined by a bunch of other groups, mostly local in the Grass Valley, Marysville area, Sacramento. You can get all this information on the Code Pink website, because I don't have stuff with me that has those addresses. And then the last thing I want to invite you to do is to donate, if you're able to the Expose Facts organization. It is now a GoFundMe site called Expose, not with a D. I thought it was Expose, but it's Expose Facts. And this is the website that is raising money to help the legal teams defend the drone whistleblowers. And it is really important that people donate if they're able to, because the lawyers who are defending the drone whistleblowers have no other source of income. Many of them are working for free. So I invite you to donate through Expose Facts, the GoFundMe site, to join us at Creech Air Force Base this spring for our spring offensive, and to join us at Beale Air Force Base, which is near Marysville, California. Thank you.
I recommend that you go to Creech Air Force Base in the Nevada desert. It's a beautiful place except for the drones flying overhead, which is very eerie. And if you haven't been there before, please do join us there. I just want to say that, want to say 1 minute about this left-right convergence that, is it Shahid that brought it up, or Mike? Shahid brought it up. If you haven't read Ralph Nader's book, and you don't need to read the whole thing, the idea of Ralph Nader's book, Unstoppable, is that the left and right have about 25 issues that they agree upon. And you know what? If we got together and unified, and we had some unity, we could win. There's more of us, left and right together, than there are those mainstream Democrats and Republicans who are basically the same party, the same people, corporate funded. So just something to realize, get the book or look online. Ralph Nader's got some great ideas of how we could dismantle the corporate state by joining left and right together. If you could stand to be in the same room with him, he makes jokes about that. How many people here can stand to be in the room with a right-wing person? I mean, it's hard. Woo! Okay, we have a chance. Okay, we have next we have George Lippman, then Anna Cecilia Blackshaw, and then Jean Herman, and we will wrap up. If you want to stay and brainstorm, I know it's been a really long night, and you have some great ideas about how to protect our votes, please do stay after. Okay, George, here he is, my hero. And the reason I say that, I have to just say, George Lippman is a real treasure in the city of Berkeley because of all the work he does. He's not only on the Police Review Commission, he's on the Peace and Justice Commission, chairing that commission. And thank you, George, for coming. Go.
Everybody, thank you. Thank you to Cynthia and to the UU Federation Fellowship for hosting this event. I am going to talk a little bit about local, specific, and constructive ideas that we can do as requested by the organizers. I'm going to talk primarily about policing and broadly, and what's going on. First, what's going on in this community, and then what we can do about it. The whole country has basically been in shell shock for the last 2 years because of the epidemic of killings of African Americans and Latinos by the police. It's late, people know the history, I'm not going to go into the list. It's still going on across the Bay in San Francisco with the case of Mario Woods, which a supervisor in San Francisco described as being shot by an ethnically diverse firing squad. Here in Berkeley, political leaders like to brag about the quote-unquote best police department in the country. According to the chief of police, the department is liberal, even progressive. It does not racially profile. The reality is described by the Berkeley NAACP is that there are two Berkeleys. This means that the majority of white Berkeleyans have no understanding of the experience of policing that African Americans in South Berkeley have. It means that every single African American has a story about being pulled over repeatedly by Berkeley cops for no reason, searched, handcuffed, harassed, only to be released without charges. Finally, last year, like it was mentioned earlier, the community was able to get a look at the police department's own statistics, gathered under the new fair and impartial policing policy. And they are damning. They show that when black people are stopped by the Berkeley police, they are subject to a search 22% of the time, whereas whites are searched only 7% of the time, a discrepancy of more than 3-1. Worse, African Americans are released with only a warning 64% of the time, but for whites only 41%, which is much more often black people are searched and the stop produces no evidence, contraband, or weapon that justified the police action. In other words, they're stopped for no reason. There are other issues as well that could mostly be considered civil liberties issues. December 6, 2014 was essentially a police riot against the Black Lives Matter demonstration. It was characterized by police delivering baton strikes to the head, shooting indiscriminately into the crowd with less lethal weaponry, and dumping vast amounts of tear gas into the crowd as well, and also failing to control similar actions by other departments that they invited in through mutual aid. There are a lot of concerns about militarization of the department, ranging from the request to acquire tasers, the interest in an armored personnel carrier, participation in the annual Urban Shield exercise, and the militaristic tactics and dress sported by the police, primarily in South Berkeley. There are ongoing criticisms of the department's involvement with the national security state through reporting suspicious activity to the Intelligence Fusion Center, known as NICRIC. So now, last month, the Police Review Commission, which is an appointed body in Berkeley, appointed by city council members, set up by a popular vote, overwhelming vote, of the citizens of Berkeley in 1974. The PRC, on which I was appointed to by Jesse Arrigan, decided on 10 work priorities for the next 6 months. Here are four of them I want to call to your attention. One, revision of all the general orders or department policies, including crowd control, use of force, and mutual aid, and those come out of the review and the investigation of the events of December 2014. Number two, body-worn and dashboard cameras for the police. Number three, fair and impartial policing, especially racial profiling concerns, and review of this recently released stop data. Number four, review of the PRC's Board of Inquiry procedures, which is how we review the conduct of individual officers. At this point, I want to make clear I am not speaking for the PRC. The PRC is the closest thing we have in Berkeley to civilian oversight. It was established to advise the City Council on policies, practices, and procedures in relation to law enforcement and without, I quote, without limitations. That's in the law. But to get to the point, what do you think happens when the community is not engaged with the PRC process? Well, then only the police department is engaged with the PRC. And what happens to the PRC's independence from the police, its ability to criticize and to advise the council and the people how to transform policing? It disappears. And many people say this is exactly what has happened over the last 40 years. So as a police review commissioner, I plead with you to engage with the PRC, to bring your complaints, your suggestions, and your visions for transformation. Attend the PRC meetings, second and fourth Wednesdays of the month, 7 p.m. at the South Berkeley Senior Center. Too many times, the only people at the meetings, aside from commissioners, are the police brass, the police association, maybe the Daily Cal. We need your voice. Let's look a little more deeply, but briefly, into the four issues I mentioned. First is the issue of police cameras, and I'll be honest, there's a lot of debate among progressive people about police cameras. I believe, based on numerous conversations I've had with black leaders and civil rights attorneys, that body cameras must be adopted as quickly as possible, as they lead to sharp declines both in the use of police force and in the unnecessary entrance of people of color into the mass incarceration system. Some raise concerns that the cameras will increase electronic surveillance and degrade privacy rights. These concerns must also be addressed in the policy. Will the PRC write a strong policy that institutes cameras and protect people's rights? It depends on the community's engagement with the process. Secondly, the issue of revising police policies on crowd control, use of force, and mutual aid. I believe the Commission's investigation of December 2014 police riot produced a pretty good report that laid major responsibility on the department for overwhelming an anti-racist march. After the City Council reviews the Commission's report on January 26th, the Commission will work with the BPD to write actual policy language to prevent such incidents in the future. Will the PRC write effective policy on these issues and not allow itself to be swayed off track by the police? It depends on the community's engagement. Next is the issue of racial profiling. At least two aspects need to change. First, a process must be developed within the department to utilize the demographic data to drill down and find the cops and the squads who are doing the profiling and correct their behavior. Also, the process must be overseen by civilians. The PRC must review the department's corrective process and ensure that it is working. Will the PRC write effective policy to end racial profiling and not allow itself to be swayed off track by the police? It depends on the community's engagement. Thank you. Fourth, and finally, is the PRC's Board of Inquiry procedures. Many of the constraints on true civilian oversight are imposed by state law due to the power of the Police Officers Association. But there are additional constraints imposed by the City of Berkeley or by the Commission itself. And often we find that we are stymied by all these rules and are not able to produce a recommendation for I won't say for discipline directly, but for the department to look further into the matter. Will the Commission assert its full power under the law and once again become the focus of civilian oversight that it was created to be? It depends on the community's engagement. I believe the community needs to develop an overall approach to transforming policing. Not a single issue approach. One that unites both civil rights and civil liberty struggles. People are in struggle over many of the issues I've discussed, but we lack a coordinated campaign to fight for across-the-board change and for a positive view of the public safety function in Berkeley. This community must create such a coalition of diverse interests in order to prevail on the PRC, the City Council, and the Police Department. Thank you.
Anna is with the Standing Up for Racial Justice group, which supports Black-led efforts to stop racial profiling, brutality, and murder. And then after that, Jean Herman.
Before we have our last two speakers, I want to have a big hand for Cynthia. It's really unique and a landmark event. I've never been to an event like this. A multi-racial, multi-issue full day, and I think it's maybe it'll happen somewhere else as well, but you really made it happen, Cynthia. So thank you very much.
That was valuable. I think we might do it every couple of months and get back together.
Thanks so much, and thanks for having me here and organizing this event. So I'm with an organization called Showing Up for Racial Justice. We are a national organization that was started after Obama's election when we saw a resurgence of violence against black churches and the backlash in the wake of Obama's election. However, Surge really didn't get off the ground until the last couple of years with the growing movements, Ferguson Action, and the sort of growing awareness around police brutality against communities of color. I also am part of the Surge Bay Area.
So at Surge, we really orient our organizing around activating folks who are already on the move. We organize white folks to be part of a multiracial movement for justice. That's not to say that we're a white-only organization, but our intention is to really organize folks, white anti-racist allies, who would already call themselves an anti-racist ally, but who are looking to deepen and to create more meaningful connections to this work, to really show up in a way, if we're going to be able to really support the Black-led organizing that's happening right now around the country. And just in the last year, I mean, our message is really resonating. Just in the last year, there's been over 130 new Surge chapters that are popping up all over the country. So I feel like white folks really want to be part of this movement. They really want to figure out how to deepen their racial literacy skills, how to have more meaningful conversations with their friends, their neighbors, and to figure out what we can do every day to stand up to white supremacy. So I just want to quickly go over some of our shared values. We talk about calling in, not calling out. I'm sure every single one of us in the room has had those frustrating conversations with other white folks who haven't, who think of racism in very individualized terms rather than thinking about systemic racism. So we really try to create avenues for people to really deepen those racial literacy skills and to feel really confident in having those conversations, because we all know it's not enough to just say that we are against racism. You know, we have to really confront systemic racism in a way that actually can move policy and to really show that we're a movement that's really standing up for racial justice. A quote that I like to say is by the white civil rights activist Ann Braden. She says, "The battle is and always has been a battle for the hearts and minds of white people in this country. The fight against racism is our issue. It's not something that we're called on to help people of color with. We need to become involved with it as if our lives depended on it, because in truth, they do." So we really like this idea of mutual interest and this idea of collective liberation. And folks ask me sometimes, like, well, isn't that awkward that you're only organizing white people? And of course, we're not only organizing white people. Our meetings are welcome to all. But one of the things that's really exciting to me about this movement, and many of you have many more years of experience than I do, but what I see happening is that white folks have really been asked to step back. And we are, what's happening with Black Lives Matter is the Black leadership that is so exciting, and making space for developing new leadership and asking white folks to participate as allies. And I feel like that's really happening in a way where we are just seeing a lot of exciting and smart strategic organizing. And I think it's really important for us as white allies to recognize and to be proud in our role as white allies. So that idea of mutual interest is really important. The other idea is taking risks, learning and keep going, putting ourselves and our lives on the line, in a way that people of color are forced to deal with in their daily lives. Accountability through action. We work closely with Black-led organizations to really determine how we can step up and be in solidarity with their actions and with the work they're doing while organizing in our communities. Our idea is to have 7 million white folks in the next 7 years who are actively engaged in this struggle. Another issue is enough for everyone. As we all know, the sort of global international capitalist economy basically makes us feel like we're always in this scarcity mode. We believe that there is enough for everybody, and it's about how resources are distributed. And that's what's important. So We would love to have you join us at Surge. We have our meetings. We have our next general meeting next Wednesday, this Wednesday in downtown Oakland. That's Surge Bay Area. It's at Oak Stop and Telegraph. You can find us on Facebook, both nationally. The National Surge has a website, as well as the Bay Area Surge. And I also just want to quickly let you fill you in on a few of the actions that are happening in the upcoming Martin Luther King weekend. So the Anti-Police Terror Project has spearheaded 96, the second year in a row, 96 hours of action to celebrate the radical Martin Luther King, to bring awareness around really the, you know, anti-imperialism, anti-military, the global economic analysis that he was making, and to try to bring more truth to sort of the whitewashing of Martin Luther King. So in that spirit, there are a number of different events throughout the weekend. I don't have all of them here, but there is a calendar that you can find through the Anti-Police Terror Project. But some of them, for example, on the 18th, that's the Monday, the march is gonna be 11 o'clock, gonna meet at Oscar Grant Plaza or Frank Agawa Plaza in downtown Oakland. At 9 o'clock that morning, there's gonna be a family-friendly teach-in. To help folks develop skills to have more meaningful conversations with kids about racism. One of the last things I'll end on, because I know we're just nearing the end, is that I work on the committee with youth and families. 40 years ago in Los Angeles, my parents were integrationists. And in Los Angeles, where I live, we were the first school district to be federally mandated by the Supreme Court to do busing. And for when that happened in our family, it was a celebration for us, something that we had won. And of course, we know what happened, white flight, white people leaving those districts, you know, creating us today more segregated schools than we had back then. But what I noticed, I have a 10-year-old son, and every year at Black History Month, he comes home with the same colorblind narratives, the same, you know, Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King materials that 40 years ago I came home with in my public schools. And I think that it really shows that as white folks, you know, we have a long way to go in really helping our fellow white folks address privilege and really move the needle. So I know that all of you have been part of this movement. I invite you to join Surge. Help us get to those 7 million white voices standing up and showing up for racial justice. And I thank you for your activism, the wisdom I've learned from many of you over the years, and I am excited to be with you on this struggle for global social economic justice. So thank you for organizing.
I'm speaking very briefly on behalf of Cecile Pinetta, who could not come here tonight, but she was going to speak tonight also on racial justice, and she hurt her foot and regrets that she couldn't come. Please come back here in 2 weeks at 7 p.m. She will be reading from and discussing her latest book, Apology to a Whale, Words to Mend a World. She's a very witty and brilliant writer and speaker, so I know you'll enjoy that in 2 weeks.
Thanks so much, Anna. That was a great address. Before I invite, actually I'd like Jean Herman to come up and just wrap up. And I invite you to sign our email list up there so you can hear about the future gatherings that we're going to be having. And also, all of the presenters tonight have actions that you can take part in. If we have your email address, we can let you know about those. So thank you. And here's Jean. Thank you, Jean.
Before, I want to acknowledge a member of our fellowship community who has returned to us tonight from a series of operations, Holly Harwood, a long-time member of Poetry and a valuable member of this community. Okay, it's obvious that the police departments in this United States need to be reformed. We're on the way with what we already had at our first forum. So we need community policing, not pig policing or current police practices. We need police who can use their words and not their bullets. Police who have awareness and compassion rather than bullying with and blind brutality. So, at our next forum on January 19th, right here at 6 o'clock, we have a potluck, 7 o'clock, we will address how police are recruited, hired, and trained, the transition of military veterans to the police department, mental health issues, including PTSD, and include psychological testing and evaluation of all applicants before they join the police department, and transfer of police officers with questionable history from one department to Berkeley. We don't need that. We need to put some teeth into the police review commission, and I will talk to George about what needs to be done. And police academy, before a police enters into contract, he needs to know something about the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and LGBT issues. And he also needs to know something about respect. Most of the police in this country are clueless about that. We will address these issues January 19th, Tuesday, a week before the Police Review Commission, and we will have an initiative for the Board of whoever they are, City Council. Okay. Thank you. It's been a great night, and you. Thank you.
Thank you, Gene. We're going to go.